My name is Andrew Kamanga. I'm currently the president of the Football Association of Zambia. I got elected on 20th March 2016 for a four-year term. I did campaign on a platform of transparency, accountability and integrity as the key pillars for managing football. And I think I have repaid the membership and the football family by continuing on that path. The first challenge we had as an executive coming into FAS was obviously the insistence by FIFA that we change the constitution and align it to the modern FIFA statutes. And we went through that process, and it also created an opportunity for us to align ourselves in terms of how we were going to manage football going forward. So if you look at the 2017 constitutional amendment, it realigned the management of the game by leagues, and we had the Super League, the National Division 1 on one hand, which we are now calling the commercial side of the game, which is essentially the Zambia Premier League, and then the rest of the provinces were reorganized into provincial leagues with Division 1, Division 2, Division 3. In some provinces, we've even gone as far as Division 4. And we also have the women's game as well as part of that development. So the commercial side hasn't been difficult to manage because it's a sponsored league. If you look at the changes we made there, they were more cosmetic, but very fundamental. Again, coming back to our mantra of transparency, accountability, and integrity, we did engage the Super League teams. In the past, teams were going away with as little as 7,000 from the MTN League. But once we had a meeting, we agreed that going forward, we'll reorganize how the members are given the support. And from that extent, we came up with a general participation sponsorship for each member of the Super League. So some moved from as low as 7,000 to a uniform amount of 200,000. So each member now is guaranteed that 200,000 for participating in the Super League. And then of course the top three are the ones who get rewarded, because the champion takes an additional 300, the second gets an additional 150, and then the third gets an additional 100. So those are the fundamental changes. We took the under 20 team to COSAFA, and we made champions in December 2016. In 2017, we sent the team to Spain for a 1 month training, and for the first time, we saw some very good football when the team came back. You will admit that when Zambia was playing in that tournament, the stadiums were always full, whether it was on the Copper Belt or here in Lusaka. And out of that, we won the Africa Cup Under 20 for the first time in the history of the tournament. And as a result, we qualified to the World Cup. Again, we sent the team to a four-nation tournament in South Korea, which was part of the preparations. And then they also went back to Spain to polish up the final preparations. And then from there, they went again, participated in the World Cup Under 20. If you remember, in 2007, this was the same team which played in the Under 20 World Cup. But they went up to the second round. But in 2017, we set a new record by going up to the quarterfinal. And had it not been for one or two mistakes here and there, we could have gone far in that tournament. So again, we set a new standard with by going to the quarterfinal at the under 20 level. If you come to the under 23, yes, the same under 20 team was quickly upgraded to the under 23, and they qualified to the 2019 edition of the under 23 tournament. Unfortunately, they didn't do very well, but of course, out of that under 20 team, we saw at least five of the players going into Europe, which was a good start, and these now have formed the backbone of the new Chipolopolo senior national team. If you look at the women's team, yes, they did very well in 2016-2017 in the COSAFA tournaments. Of course, they also qualified to the Africa Cup in 2018, and we were in a strong group where the two winners from our group, South Africa and Nigeria, ended up representing Africa in the Women's World Cup. So you can see that our women's game has been on the rise by going into Africa Cup. And then, of course, last year, or rather this year, we played the final qualifiers for the Olympics, and we succeeded. And for the first time, again, we've set a new standard. We've qualified to the Olympics for the women's game. Now, in 2019, our women's team also participated in the COSAFA tournaments at under 17, where they came out third, under 20, where they came out second, and the senior national team, where they came out second. So out of the three groupings, we were second in two and third in one. On the men's side, 2019 was very successful because we became the champions at senior. We were champions for under 20, and we were also champions at under 17. So in the 4 years that our executive has been in office, we've actually delivered six gold cups, if you like. So we've been number one six times. And obviously others will argue and say it's COSAFA, but it's the same cycle that you have to look at. And coming to the Chipolopolo, we haven't done very well. Yes, simply because, again, like I said, if you look at the success of Chipolopolo, the under 20 team which participated in the World Cup in 2007 was the main team which matured and became the champions in 2012. Then unfortunately, we started dropping in 2013 because the same team got knocked out in the first round. And then 2017 AFCON qualifiers, we couldn't go because the team hadn't been changed that much. In 2019, we also didn't qualify. But I'm happy to report that based on the success of the under 17, under 20, under 23, by the way, in 2018, we also qualified to CHAN, and we also qualified to the CHAN tournament in 2020. So much as one would say we haven't been to the main AFCON, but we've consistently, in the last 4 years, been building from the bottom. And where we are today, we've got a very strong opportunity to build an even stronger Chipolopolo national team, particularly that we've now engaged a coach who we believe is going to assemble the best Chipolopolo team. I think so far he's looked at some players from the under 17, under 20, under 23, and those who are going to CHAN, and they also make up part of the senior national team. So you can clearly see that we are rebounding. Of course, the 2021 AFCON qualifiers, we didn't start off very well. We lost the first two games, but we have an opportunity to recover and make up for the remaining four games. And I also want to take this opportunity to just put this emphasis on AFCON qualifying as a target. That what we need to obviously look at is football evolves. And we've only been in the Africa Cup finals in the last 55 years, three times. So you've got 1974, 1994, and 2012. And in there, we've only won the cup once. Now, If you compare the same period, our colleagues have been able to win the Africa Cup. Egypt, for example, have done it seven times. Cameroon have won AFCON five times. Ghana have won it four times. Nigeria have won it three times. Of course, even our neighbors, DRC, have won it twice. There's so many teams that have had success with AFCON. We've only been there once. So what we need to say is, can we now start thinking of not participating in the AFCON, but winning our second AFCON, our third AFCON, and all these projects now are sitting with our vision for the next 10 years. And I think in the next 10 years, between 2020 and 2030, we are looking at going to the Africa Cup five times. We are looking at going to the World Cup with three opportunities. We are likely to qualify to the World Cup for the first time in the next 10 years. And we hope that we'll be ambitious enough to be able to achieve new milestones. So it's pointless qualifying to Africa Cup, but it's important that we should be ambitious enough to win our second cup, our third cup. And I think this is why we are building from the bottom. And I'm very, very excited that as part of that building, we've now had to reorganize even the way we train. We've had capacity building for club officials. We've also extended that to the technical benches. Recently, we had training programs for the video analysis for all the teams in the Super League and National Division One. We also, for the first time, organized goalkeepers, coaches for all the teams in the Super League and National Division One. So we are starting with the National Division One and Super League, and we will extend to the development leagues. Particularly, our coaching platform is being reorganized. We've just signed up with our colleagues from Croatia, who have graciously agreed to help us set up a coaching school where we are now going to train different coaches, because previously our coaches were focusing on these short-term training programs. But we think that with the new curriculum, we want to take our coaches through a long-term coaching platform where they are now going to train for a period of 3 years, and they will specialize in different aspects. Others will be for junior teams, others will be for competitive teams. So we are changing the entire coaching platform. And through the technical director's office, I think we are already moving with our colleagues from Croatia. If you remember, we had talked about sending a few of our coaches into Europe. That program is still on, but before doing that, we wanted to make sure that we upgrade the skills of all our coaches. So we are giving a refresher course for all the coaches in the Super League and National Division One. And then from there, we can now move on to that program of sending our coaches into Europe for at least a year. And then with that, we hope that we can now start focusing. So you can clearly see that in the 4 years, we've spent more time building a very strong foundation, which is where now we are saying, we are asking our members in FAS to judge us on the successes of what we've delivered. If you look at the development leagues, for the first time in the last 4 years, we introduced equipment support, where we are giving all the teams from Division 1 up to Division 3, we are giving them a set of jerseys, 5 footballs. We are also giving them a small grant of 5,000. But in the next 4 years, we want to also make it a bit competitive. Division 1, we want to give them 15,000. Division 2, we want to give them 10,000. Division 3, we want to give them 7,500. Division 4 will continue with the 5,000. So that we put in more resources into the development leagues. All the FIFA forward funding is going into development. And if you recall, We recently signed up with the Ministry of Sport, where we want to upgrade some infrastructure in the provinces. And it is our desire that we should have at least one good stadium in each province. So for those five, we'll do a rehabilitation, and the next five will build new ones. So that is the program we want to continue in the next 4 years. And we hope that we will now have an opportunity to even make some further changes on the development side. What are we saying? We want to reorganize all the leagues so that they are by age group, because this development side should be a pool where the commercial leagues are pulling players to move over to the other side. Now, how do we do it? We want to make sure that, for instance, National Division 1 in the provinces is going to be at under 21. Provincial Division 1 will be at under 21. Division 2 will be under 19. Division 3 will be under 17. Division 4 will be under 15. Division 5 will be under 13. Division 6 will be under 11. Now, if we have that platform, and by the way, again, going back to 2017, we made some strategic constitutional changes where, for the first time this year, we've been able to elect new executive members in each province. And in there, whoever is elected chairman in the province automatically sits in the first executive. So at the national level, we are only going to elect the president, vice, and a female candidate. So the new executive will have 13 members, 10 drawn from the 10 provinces and the 3 at the national level. Now, the reason is simple. We've decentralized our operations. We want each province to have a mini FAS, and that's exactly what we are saying. So the provincial chairman, the vice, a youth person, a women's league person, they will now form the core of the executive to run football in their province. So this is where we are now going to put in more effort. Again, I just remembered, for the first time in the provinces, we've introduced FAS provincial cups. So we've got 10 provincial cups where we are putting in competition in the provinces. All the champions will be given a winning bonus for the cup. And we hope that with the challenge that we have around sponsorship, the provincial executives will now have the task of improving and getting more sponsors so that we make the games more attractive in their provinces. So these are the fundamental changes which have become very key, and going forward, they are so instrumental for the next 4 years. So we've delivered the first 4 years, and we think that we will deliver in the next 4 years. I can assure the public and our football family that we've built a very strong foundation. Going forward, you should now see Chipolopolo rebounding, the women's team doing very well. We hope that they can also, in the next 4 years, qualify to the Women's World Cup for the first time. They've done it with the Olympics, and we also want not to stop with our ambitious program of investing in grassroots. For the first time, we are sending an under-15 team to Croatia to go and participate in an 8-nation tournament. This is the first, and we are also going to have a national team at under-13, at under-11, so that as we build on these platforms, we make sure that as the young players are coming up, at any given time, we've got provincial teams in different age groups, and it becomes easy to give all players across the country, regardless of the group they are in, an opportunity to play for the national team. Even this under-15 team, I'm very happy that we've had players. In fact, the main striker is from Northern Province. This has never happened. Of course, in the competitive league, in the Super League, we've also introduced for the first time an under-16 league, which is working very well. It's being managed in collaboration with Barca Academy, where we've signed up an MOU with them. But we are replicating that under-16 league with we want to take it to the Copper Belt as well, so that it becomes now a national league at under 16. So you can clearly see that our approach is bottom up, and once we have more players, getting the different national teams will be a lot easier. Again, for the first time, we've got our own brand, the Copper brand, which is one of the ways in which we want to make fans financially independent. We want our soccer fans to support the Chipolopolo brand. I think through the marketing department, we will even have more products available. Other than replicas, we'll have tracksuits and all the gear that comes with the identity of Chipolopolo as a brand. We are also looking to raise a $10 million Chipolopolo bond so that we can try and become financially independent. And I think the model for that is, again, we are looking at a situation where one day government may not be there to give us the financial support that we've continued drawing on. As you can understand, government has got many needs, and if FAS can be financially independent, we will take away the burden from government. And football, as you would expect, is a big commercial industry, and this is why we need to commercialize all aspects of the game, from the sponsored leagues to the bond raising, and then ultimately whatever we are getting from FIFA will be directed towards the development leagues across the country. So in a nutshell, that gives you a flavor of what we are trying to do, what we are going to do. In the next 4 years, if the members give us the vote, I'm prepared to serve and continue on the same path of transparency, accountability and integrity, because that's the hallmark of modern management. And with those, we should be able to now see how we develop and manage the game in the next 4 years. Whether we are there or not, the foundation we've built in the last 4 years, the next 4 years, and the 10-year strategic plan is what will take Zambian football forward. So we've laid the foundation. Let's build. Others will come in. For the first time, we've got leadership from the provinces. We just need to enhance on that, so that every aspect of the game becomes easy to manage. We've decentralized, we are putting in more resources, and with that we again hope that Chipolopolo will rise. We can win our second Africa Cup, our third one, go to our maiden World Cup appearance. We are targeting 2022, and even 2026 we should still be in there, and hopefully Zambian football will be transformed forever going forward.